Production of I'm in the Truth Business, William Bradford Huie, was made possible in part by a grant from the Alabama Humanities Foundation, a state program of the National Endowment for the Humanities.
William Bradford Huie made money, and money made him. In 1955, Huie came to this Mississippi town to investigate one of the most notorious hate crimes of the century, the murder of a black teenager, Emmett Till. Determined to find the truth, Huie invented the controversial practice of checkbook journalism when he paid $4,000 to two white men who admitted they had shot Till in the head, tied a cotton gin fan to his neck, and thrown him in the Tallahatchie River.
Whenever two men take a third man out at night, midnight, and kill him, there are no innocent bystanders to tell you what happened. The victim is dead. The only people who can tell you how and why that murder was committed are murderers.
And I believe he was the finest investigative reporter I've ever met. And that was before there was such a term as investigative reporter.
I think anyone who is a historian of that period is very fortunate if they happen to come across a moment where William Bradford Huie is at work, because then you really get a window into the human drama of the situation. You're not just dealing with dry facts and sort of historical accounts of what happened and who went where and who said what.
William Bradford Huie's name is not as familiar as it once was, but in the course of an extraordinary career, this gifted writer from a small Alabama town sold more than 28 million books. Seven of his works were made into films, one of them becoming the most watched television movie of its time. 14 of his books were bestsellers. He was present at and wrote passionately about the major historical events of his era, the Great Depression, the Second World War, and the Civil Rights Movement. And through it all, he claimed he was always after one thing.
I want to know the truth. I'm not in the law enforcement business. I'm just in the business of establishing truth wherever possible. And I have to believe that the truth is good.
In the summer of 1955, Emmett Till, a Chicago boy, was sent by his mother to spend the summer with relatives near Money, Mississippi. It was his first trip to the South. He didn't understand the code that governed relations between blacks and whites. Showing off for his country cousins, he entered a small store that catered to field hands. Depending on who tells the story, he whistled at or spoke out of turn or touched Carolyn Bryant, the white woman who was working inside. The next night, two white men, armed with a revolver, came to the house where Till was staying and asked for the boy who had done the talking. 3 days later, a fisherman discovered his badly decomposed body in the Tallahatchie River.
It was written about extensively in and out of the South. And it was the first occasion when reporters from outside the South came flooding in to a Southern community and brought about the confrontation between the outsiders and the law enforcement people.
Roy Bryant and J.W. Milam admitted abducting Till, but denied killing him. In a sensational trial in Sumner, they were acquitted of murder by a jury of their peers, 12 white men. The jury deliberated just over an hour.
This was a matter of considerable international attention because it, in effect, told a story that national and international audiences were able to, in a sense, understand in terms of the racial crisis that Americans, white Americans, had been either living with or seeking to avoid for decades, if not for centuries.
The courts had failed to establish the truth, The world was no closer to learning who was responsible for this notorious killing. William Bradford Huie didn't know any of the principals involved in the case, but he did know human nature. 4 months after the verdict, he drove to Mississippi and made this bold proposition to the attorney who had represented Milam and Bryant.
I want these two men to come in here and tell me the truth. But I think it's the best thing. They're not in jeopardy any longer, and I don't see why they shouldn't. And I said, I want to make a film of it.
And he had, he has told me about leaving his home in Hartsel early in the morning, driving down to Mississippi on the way and stopping on the side of the road and throwing up, that he was so afraid and that he was sick, and that he turned around and started back more than once and turned back around and went on.
And he told me, he said, what you have to do in a situation like this is to set up the deal. You know who you have to get, and you make a just a straight-out proposal to him.
And so I'm willing to buy what we call betrayal rights, and I'm willing to pay him about $4,000 for their betrayal rights if he'll come in here and tell me the truth. Now, you tell them that they must tell me the truth. They must give me ways so that in the daytime I can go out and verify that they're telling me the truth. And if I find them telling me a lie, I won't pay them a damn thing.
You know, he told more than once that he was a great believer in a $50 bill because it made twice as high a stack as a $100 bill would make. And if you went into a little town in Mississippi where people had very little money and you had a big stack of $50 bills, that tended to impress them.
I would be pretty confident in saying that in the Till case, Milam and Bryant would not have talked except for money.
I mean, he had thought about it. He had it down to a science that way. He said, because these people are greedy. He said, first of all, you know they're sorry, no good sons of bitches to begin with. You go in there, and you know, in some cases like this, they're murderers. But he said they're greedy. And you open it up and say they're poor, white, trash, rednecks. You open up that suitcase, and there's these piles of $20 bills. He said they can't stand it. They got to have it.
Protected from further prosecution, Milam and Bryant agreed to tell their story.
Well, J.W. did the killing. J.W. fired the shot that killed, when they took him down on the river and killed him. Now, as I have written, they did not intend to kill him when they went and got him. And they killed him because he boasted of having a white girl and showed them the pictures of a white girl in Chicago.
Huie met with the killers in secret every night for a week. Each day, he retraced their steps to check the accuracy of their story.
Young Till never realized the danger he was in. I'm quite sure that he never thought these two men would kill him. Or maybe he's just in such a strange environment, he doesn't know what he's up against.
Emmett Till's mother had shocked the world when she opened the casket at her son's funeral, revealing his grotesque figure. I want the world to see what these people have done, she said. Now, Huie, in print, was telling the world how and why the murder was committed.
He exposed for the first time, fully and effectively and immediately, the minds and motives of killers, to see not only blacks as victims, but to understand why they had been victimized by men who were themselves not at all repentant, not at all remorseful.
But J.W. Milam looked up at me and said, well, when he told me about this white girl he had, he says, my friend, that's what this war is about down here now. He says, that's what we got to fight to protect. And he says, I just looked at him and I said, boy, you ain't gonna never see the sun come up again.
Huie's story of the murder was published in Look magazine and later in his book, Wolf Whistle.
This was something that really brought home the depths to which an extremist defense of racial segregation would go. And it was certainly a contributing factor that built up into the civil rights movement of the 1960s.
Huie might have been regarded as a champion of the civil rights movement if he had not decided to tell something else he learned through a fantastic coincidence. Emmett Till's father had been killed in the Second World War. Life magazine made much of the irony that the son of a soldier fighting the Nazis overseas would be murdered by racists at home. A year earlier, in 1954, Huie had published The Execution of Private Slovak, his account of the only U.S. serviceman in World War II shot for desertion.
96 Americans were executed during the Second World War, 95 of them for murder and or rape, and Slovak was executed for desertion. And all 96 of those men are buried in a secret plot in a near or adjoining an American cemetery in northern France.
The executed soldiers rest in unmarked graves, but Huie knew who was buried where. He had secretly copied the cemetery diagram when he was briefly left alone in a Pentagon office.
I'm the only man outside somewhere in the depths of the Pentagon that's got that key. And after I read this piece in Life, I whirled around, picked up that key, and I looked just three graves from Eddie Slovak, and I saw Private Louis Till. Now, this only means that the man has been executed for rape and or murder. And I said, oh, no, this can't be the same man.
Huie's revelations about the execution of Louis Till cost the burgeoning civil rights movement support, some liberals said. Some newspaper men attacked Huie, saying his checkbook journalism discredited his reporting.
Most reporters of my acquaintance think checkbook journalism is bad business. And I think they sincerely resented that Bill did it.
But here's the thing about checkbook journalism and the great danger and the reason that the New York Times and the Washington Post and the Wall Street Journal don't practice it is simply that it might invite people to invent stories at the worst or at the margin distort stories so that suddenly stories become more dramatic or their role in it becomes more central so that their story is worth more and you're willing to pay more to get their story.
We, the consumers of stories that are generated by that transaction, have to be satisfied that the truth is being told. If the truth is independently corroborated, or if we have every reason to believe that what is true has been told, the fact that it has been fetched up by paying the person either for his time or even something beyond his time, it doesn't shock me.
Damn right. I think it's worth $5,000, $10,000, whatever it needs to be paid for, if that's what it takes to get that story.
He'd scooped those other people, and he was operating outside the mainstream, and I think a lot of reporters resented him. The checkbook journalism was only part of it.
Huie's graphic, dramatic account in Look magazine, and then, of course, subsequently in the paperback edition entitled Wolf Whistle, was really among the most searing moments, I think, in the period of the 1950s that made clear the extent to which some Southern whites would go in defense of racial segregation.
9 years later, in 1964, racial violence exploded in Mississippi again. It was Freedom Summer. Andrew Goodman, James Cheney, and Mickey Schwerner, working to register black voters, were missing. The FBI found their car abandoned and burned, but the FBI could not find the young men or their bodies. The New York Herald Tribune sent Huie to Philadelphia, Mississippi, to find the truth. Huie believed there was only one way to get the story.
A lot of people resent informers. They resent paying informers. I don't recommend it. I just don't know any other better plan. I think that there's a pretty good case for using informers, even for paying informers.
44 days after the workers disappeared, their bodies were discovered buried in an earthen dam. 4 months later, federal authorities indicted 21 men for conspiring to violate the civil rights of Goodman, Schwerner, and Cheney. Statements from paid informants were crucial to the FBI's investigation.
I urged the FBI to pay for the bodies earlier than they did. I was working by July the 15th or 16th. I was working with a plan to buy the bodies because I knew the bodies would never be found in any other way.
Huie's book, Three Lives for Mississippi, was published less than 4 months after the indictments and more than 3 years before the case came to court. In it, Huie wrote that the Klan sponsored the murders in a conspiracy that involved top local law enforcement officials. And again, he was criticized for his methods.
Certainly it is not an ideal situation. Certainly it is a situation that invites cynicism. But I just don't know any other way. Yes, ma'am.
I think that book probably had more conjecture, you know, than anything he did of that nature, because that was so sensational that he relied on paid informants who really weren't knowledgeable as much as the FBI's sources. Now, the FBI, we now know, pretty much had a handle on their key suspects within 24 hours.
As I believe to this moment, Huie was very instrumental in helping to really get the truth out about what was happening and passing tips on to people in terms of the inner workings of the minds and truths of that story until you finally get, of course, the big break that reveals where the boys are buried.
It took somebody with Bill's own Southern accent to get in there and meet people. And yes, I think he had to pay off some of those people in order for them to risk putting their lives on the line with the Klan.
The national media had descended on Mississippi to cover these two sensational murder stories. They reported the news and then left. But to explain why these events happened, it would take an unusual Southerner. Alabama's rich black belt of flat land created a powerful plantation society. But in the northern part of the state, the Appalachian foothills created a different culture. People of Scots-Irish descent scratched out a living, tending small stands of corn. The farms were so small, there was little need for slave labor.
Well, William Faulkner makes that distinction in Absalom Absalom. He says that upcountry people, hill people, and mountain south people tend to judge a man more on his abilities, whether he keeps his word, his personal dignity. And Faulkner says in the Black Belt, in the Tidewater, they're much more concerned with race, and property, the plantation, money, the big house, family. There's a difference between the two Souths.
When you look at the North Alabama counties, and particularly the mountain counties, these were not slaveholding counties, and they didn't have the burden of racism that applied to the South Alabama counties, and they didn't have the attitude of defiance toward the federal government.
William Bradford Huie was born in Hartsel, Alabama in 1910. His grandfather charged with Pickett at Gettysburg, but regretted joining the Confederacy, saying it was a poor man's fight and a rich man's war. Huie's father was a farmer and railroad man.
He was an adorable little child and obviously was very bright from the beginning.
Bill Huie was every teacher's favorite student. He was double promoted to the second grade. By the third grade, he was a writer, exchanging love notes with Ruth, his sweetheart, to whom he would be married for 39 years. He was an Eagle Scout, high school valedictorian.
Bill was very well educated and very disciplined by his mother.
Huie's people were shaped by the land. He was shaped by his mother.
I had the feeling that his mother wanted him to rise above his father, which is why she pushed him.
Well, I think she was very, very much a critical factor, the critical factor.
Huie was the first person in his family to go to college. To save the University of Alabama in the Depression, its president advertised for students in the New York papers. Thousands of Yankee parents found a bargain when they sent their children to Tuscaloosa.
Well, up until the time Bill Huie came to school, university had been, as they say, built for planters' sons, and he might have expected to go to school with mainly the sons of South Alabama. But in fact, the student body at that point was composed of socialists from Chicago and a great percentage of Jewish students from New York and New Jersey. And there was Bill Huie, an open-minded young man, prepared to meet these people, talk with them, learn from them. I think it affected him for the rest of his life.
Huie had to earn money to stay in school and send home to his struggling family. He graded papers for a professor. He typed papers for students. He'd even write them. Huie entered the university intending to become a writer or lawyer. But in his freshman year, he sold a story to True Magazine, and nothing would stop him from becoming a writer. He was a dynamo, graduating Phi Beta Kappa. Now he would take the same energy and drive and attack his literary apprenticeship.
He was short and compact, and he would let somebody know by the seat of his pants, his own personal audacity, to let them know where he was and where he came from and what he was all about.
As a reporter for the Birmingham Post, Huie covered violent strikes, crime, and the controversial trial of the Scottsboro Boys. He saw how graft fueled the political machine in the state capitol. He witnessed the execution of a black man he knew to be innocent of rape. He published his own newspaper and his own magazine.
Well, Huie published his first novel, Mud on the Stars, a novel he'd been writing in the late 30s. And in that novel, he put all of those experiences, working as a newspaper reporter, covering labor unrest. It's an autobiographical novel.
Mud on the Stars is about the education of a young, cynical journalist from the North Alabama Hill Country. Garth LaFaber is fiercely proud of the Tennessee River land that has been in his family for generations. But the river must be tamed. The family land is flooded and lost when the TVA builds the dams that bring power and prosperity to the valley. The book would later be the basis for Elia Kazan's movie, Wild River, starring Lee Remick and Montgomery Clift.
Well, even in that first novel, Huie is coming to his major subject, which is the relationship between the individual and society. Individuals just have to adjust, often for the greater good.
Mud on the Stars ends with the protagonist going off to war, a witness to the most calamitous event of the century. Huie went to war too. Like most men of his generation, it would be the most important event of his life. It would provide him with his best material for 20 years.
Oh, I've had it with heroes. Every man I've loved has died in this war. But you'll never get caught in the shooting. That's one thing I'm sure of. You can't imagine how attractive that makes you to me.
Well, easy, Tiger. That's a tailored shirt.
Oh, shut up and let me kiss you.
The first dead man on Omaha Beach must be a sailor.
If you see the movie or read the book, Americanization of Emily, I could just see Bill doing just about everything the character played by James Garner does. That was just Bill.
The Navy put Huie's talents as a journalist to good use. He worked to make sure that the Navy's exploits wouldn't be overshadowed by the Army's.
Well, he was commissioned, he didn't take ROTC, I don't think. He was commissioned directly into the Navy to go work for this admiral on the basis of his experience as a journalist. That was common.
Huie's orders had him island hopping the Pacific with the Seabees to publicize the accomplishments of the Navy's construction battalion in a book called Can Do. He was right beside the Seabees as they built roads and runways under enemy fire at Guadalcanal, Tinian, Saipan, and Iwo Jima.
Well, I think some of that was written as an aid. There was sort of an element of propaganda in that for a good cause. He worked for the admiral who ran the Seabees.
In 1944, Huie and the admiral he served were in England as the world's largest naval armada was being assembled. And just like his hero in The Americanization of Emily, Huie went ashore at D-Day.
I know he was on the beach on D-Day. Now, how we got there, I don't know. I've always suspected he was a modest man talking about things like this. I don't think he was forced there in the way that Garner was in the movie by an insane admiral.
You're limping, Commander. The old wound acting up? Well, where have you been? We expected you back a week ago yesterday.
I'm sorry, I had to go to France for a few days. It's out of season this time of year.
No one worth knowing was there, I'm sure.
Very rough element going to France these days.
Oh, Charlie. Lieutenant Madison is really Bill Huie, because Bill was a little bit of an operator the way Madison was. And if you recall, Madison was not a war lover, and neither was Bill.
Well, some writers are luckier than other writers, and they have experiences that translate easily into fiction. Huie was one of those lucky writers.
Now the author of four books, accustomed to working with admirals and generals, having traveled from Omaha Beach to Okinawa, Huie was ready for the media capital of the world. Full of energy, he plunged into the world of publishing, television, lecturing, and political commentary. He could take such a risk. Mud on the Stars had made him a rich man.
In fact, it earned $161,000 in royalties. And when I was paid that, I was quite certain I was going to be rich the rest of my life. And because that was, in today's dollars, that was more than $1 million.
He was definitely knew his way around and was really at home. He knew everybody.
He was very handsome, dashing, beautiful smile, prematurely white hair, with black brows and black lashes and blue eyes. He was really stunning. And very sharp, funny.
He was extremely Southern. Very courteous, very pronounced in his civility, smiled a great deal, had kind of a simian a smile. He was almost completely bald, and he spoke with a great intensity, and yet he was conventionally relaxed by, you know, as one expects Southerners to be.
In 1951, Huie published The Revolt of Mamie Stover, just one of the books that came from his experiences in the war. The novel sold 5 million copies. Jane Russell starred in the movie playing Mamie, a Southern girl in wartime Honolulu who incorporated Henry Ford's mass production techniques into the world's oldest profession.
It's a very funny book, really. I mean, here's a woman who mass-produced prostitution. That's what she did. She had all these cribs, as they called them, and she'd go to bed with one guy, and she'd run to the next crib, and there'd be a guy waiting there, and then she'd run to the next one. It was all very funny, and Bill meant it to be funny.
Mamie Stover stood for all of the people who profited from World War II and who made something of themselves.
He wrote a very lascivious novel, The Revolt of Mamie Stover, and as I remember, published a part of it in the American Mercury, which was a pretty daring thing to do in those days.
William Faulkner once told me, he said, "You just remember one thing." He had told me that I had to think in terms of money, that that was one of his mistakes. He never made any money except about the one book he wrote about a whore. So he says, us Southerners, if we're gonna have money out of writing, we've got to write at least one book about a whore. Well, I remember that. And
Huie wrote articles for news magazines about important issues, which enhanced his reputation as a serious journalist. but he was never reluctant to write titillating risque stories for other popular magazines that would sell in the hundreds of thousands. Saga magazine called him the Boswell of the bordello.
There was one I remember about Louisiana Governor Earl Long and his romance with Blaze Starr, the stripper. I could be cynical and say he wrote about sex because it sold, but I don't really believe that. I think in the same way that I said I like to write about the engines of the human heart, I think he liked to write about what makes people who they are, and sex was part of that.
Huie used to say that he held a sales record on three major magazines, and that was Saturday Evening Post, Collier's, and Look.
He was energetic, had a sort of romantic view of things, wrote with extraordinary speed, and knew how to write copy that instantly attracted attention, whether it was fiction or nonfiction.
Huie parlayed his successes with his books and magazines into lucrative lecture tours. His political commentaries were widely published and led to a relationship with the American Mercury magazine, which he eventually owned. Soon, his reputation as a journalist enabled him to become the host of a nationally televised interview program.
It's time for the Longines Chronoscope, a television journal of the important issues of the hour.
Good evening. This is Frank Knight. May I introduce our co-editors for this edition of the Longines Chronoscope? Mr. William Bradford Huie, editor of the American Mercury.
First time I ever saw Bill Huie, I was a kid. It was a television show called Longines Chronoscope, and he was the moderator. So that was the first I ever knew that Bill Huie existed. Was there? I expect many Americans were in the same boat.
Now, where do you stand politically? You're a Democrat. Are you a conservative or a liberal Democrat? Are you a New Dealer? How do you define your own position in the Democratic politics?
Well, I define myself as a Democrat who supports the policies of the administration in cases of social legislation in quite substantially. I've tried.
Best-selling author, a lecturer in constant demand, a network television personality. One popular magazine lionized Huie. He was truly a national figure.
Well, the question to be answered here, the mystery here, is why a man who was at the peak of his career, television, journalism, a man who was doing very well, would leave the Northeast and return to Hartselle, Alabama.
But Ruth was never happy. She didn't fit in New York. I mean, her manners were lovely, but she never opened her mouth at a party. She just sat there and was terribly ill at ease.
I remember being shocked on more than one occasion by how harshly he spoke to her. He would almost explode over the most trivial problem. She didn't bring the sugar, or she didn't close the door, or whatever. And from it, I simply assumed that it was a domestic situation just full of static.
Well, his mother was there. That had a lot to do with it.
Hey, you have that many generations of your family buried in churchyards up there. It's in your genes, I would think.
I love that country, and there are many good things about it.
Huie had moved to New York to further his career and wrote about the war, the Great Crusade. Remarkably, his return to Alabama placed Huie at the center of America's next crusade. Because of his compelling account of Emmett Till's death in 1955, and perhaps because he was a Southerner, editors and readers alike were beginning to think of Huie as someone who would speak with honesty about the South.
I think you have to stop and see that through their eyes, they're seeing Huie as a Southern storyteller. They're seeing somebody who's on the ground in the South, who has connections, knows the landscape, knows the players, and is going to be able to get in there and get into the story with some feeling and some depth.
In 1956, author Zora Neale Hurston enlisted Huie's help to cover a controversial trial in Florida. Hurston, a contributor to Huie's American Mercury, was not allowed access to the jail suspect. Huie investigated the case and wrote Ruby McCollum, the story of the murder of a white physician in a rural Florida town. Huie not only revealed that the suspect, a black woman, was the physician's lover, but his account also exposed the corrupt local government that wanted to keep the story quiet and keep blacks in their place. A judge jailed Huie in an unsuccessful effort to get him off the case.
So when Bill wrote this story, it wasn't just about a scandalous love affair or anything. It was much more. They symbolized the problems, the social problems and the racial problems and the economic problems of the South.
Well, 4 years ago, I passed my 50th birthday. And the last case, after writing the Till story for Look and Reader's Digest and others and dealing with murderers in 1955, I became involved in the Ruby McCollum case in North Florida, where I was put in jail and charged with contempt of court, and it cost me $22,000 to get free of the Florida courts.
Despite his frustrations with this story, he realized that race was a huge subject that attracted many readers. Indeed, Three Lives for Mississippi, his next book on the subject, gave Huie an international audience when it was published in 1965.
Dr. King wrote, and I think it's in Three Lives for Mississippi, the Goodman Cheney book, and he never wrote a preface for any other book.
Now an authority on race relations, Huie, in his fifth novel, put the spotlight on the KKK. The Klansman was a sensation and a bestseller. Richard Burton and Lee Marvin starred in the film. In the novel, Huie unmasked the Klan and showed its inner workings, and the Klan retaliated.
And he also had run-ins with the local Klan up in Hartsell. He stood out in his driveway one night with a shotgun and a hired armed guard while these people went tearing around his street, threatening him. So I don't have any doubts of his courage.
Well, it isn't a matter of courage or anything like that. It's just that I live in Alabama. I've lived there for a long time. And I can afford to take the risk. I can afford to hire guards for my house.
He would do whatever was necessary to get a story, and included offending the law or offending gangsters. He did what he did.
I've always thought he was a courageous man and a champion of investigative journalism.
And besides, my people, that's not new for me. My people, for generations, have fought the Ku Klux Klan. And fought the terrorist. My people have never believed that racial inhumanity was a part of the Southern way of life.
Chasing the James Earl Ray story was potentially dangerous. But he was a man of great personal courage.
Well, in the James Earl Ray case, it isn't a matter of physical courage. It isn't the same thing as with the Emmett Till case, where Huie had to meet in a room with men he knew to be murderers. He never actually met James Earl Ray during this period, but it still takes a lot of nerve to defy a federal judge, risk a lawsuit, risk contempt of court charges, risk going to jail.
On the evening of April 4th, 1968, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was shot to death as he stood on the balcony of the Lorraine Motel in Memphis. Investigators recovered a rifle and determined that the assassin had fired from the window of a boarding house across the street. 66 days later, after one of the most extensive manhunts in history, James Earl Ray was arrested in London and charged with the murder. With King's death, the nation had been rocked by the third political assassination of the decade. Everyone wondered, was Ray guilty? Had he, alone, fired the shots from the boarding house, or was he part of a conspiracy? It would be months until the trial. Huie wouldn't wait. After the arrest, he paid Ray $40,000 for his story.
You could always expect him to gravitate to those big stories, like the James Earl Ray story, and often to be there first, which is what happened in that case.
Ray professed his innocence. In a series of letters to Huie from his prison cell, he recounted the year of his life as an escaped convict before the assassination. Huie investigated every move the career criminal had made and wrote about it in Look magazine. His conclusions didn't satisfy anyone.
Well, yes, well, I think the truth is that James Earl Ray decided to kill Dr. King on March the 17th, 1968. And that he came to Memphis and did indeed slay Martin Luther King.
Ray, whom I have interviewed in prison, says that he was framed, that he did not commit this crime. He says that he didn't even know this crime was about to be committed.
Millions of readers followed Huey's account in Look. But a year after the assassination, Ray pleaded guilty to the murder, though now he maintains his innocence.
The worst thing that could happen to any book was for Ray to plead guilty. That what I needed to ever break even in the case was a trial. Therefore, that the worst thing that could happen was to plead guilty. Therefore, Ray gets up and says, I had to plead. Foreman and Huie made me plead guilty in order to protect the book they were in. It is not only a lie, it's a 180-degree lie, all of which has been established.
Huie ended up saying that James Earl Ray, by himself, without the aid of others, conspired to and did, in fact, assassinate Martin Luther King, Jr.
That night when we were sitting here in the house, shortly before he died, we were talking about the various aspects of that case. Well, Huie continued to believe that James Earl Ray acted alone.
I do say, though, that I think, given his understanding of that case, I'd have to agree with him without any great debate that he concluded James Earl Ray acted alone, and he's convinced me, and nothing Ray has ever said from his prison cells or anything else has changed that.
Huie originally believed that Ray was part of a conspiracy, and he thought that story would be one of the best-selling books of all time. But Huey's extensive investigations uncovered no conspiracies.
That was his argument. That's what he said in my phone interview with him. Why in the world would I say there's not a conspiracy here when having one would have made me a lot more money? I'm keeping this thing going would have made me a lot more money.
I then had to tell my good friends at Look, and I had to tell six other foreign publishers who had paid me lots of money over the years, that the Ray story was dead. There was no money to be made because only Ray was involved in the murder. Now, why didn't I prevent all of that? Why didn't I go ahead and make money for Ray and his lawyers and break even myself and, above all, make money for Look? My good friends there and other people. Why didn't I do it? The reason I didn't do it was that it wasn't true. And there are two things that I have sworn I would never do. I will never believe something just because I want to believe it. And I will never believe something because it is profitable for me to believe it.
He Slew the Dreamer was the zenith of Huey's career as an investigative journalist and the last of his books on race. He had devoted much of his career to the subject, but why?
His motivation for doing all this. I don't know. I really don't. It would have been one of the questions I would have loved to ask him. What are you up to? Why'd you do this?
Well, I think you have to understand, Huie was not an advocate in any way. Huie was not someone that the civil rights movement could rely on as a friend in moments of need. He wasn't an antagonist, but he was sort of out there as an impartial observer.
He would say, you know, what he said, no, I haven't done anything for civil rights. I've just shown the truth. That it's not, and that's not working for civil rights.
He's written that the one thing that moved him to action most often was hypocrisy. He couldn't stand hypocrisy.
Also, I just think he was a damn good guy when it came to the race question.
He was born a Baptist and born a Democrat, but that doesn't mean he went to church every Sunday or any Sunday necessarily.
I don't think he was anything. I think he was an independent, journalist, number one.
Certainly he was considered a liberal by the Wallace administration.
No, I don't think he was a flaming liberal at all. I think with all his rambunctiousness, he reflected his upbringing and his surroundings. And although he did not support racism, I think he supported many of the ideals that the people of Hartsville, Alabama stood for.
I used to think of myself as a political conservative. Now, conservatism in the South has something to do with racism. The Wallaces and others have taken over the term conservative. So I'm embarrassed when I try to think of myself as a conservative because it now connotes racism in the South.
Well, Huie rarely, and in his best work never, wrote about big important people, politicians, generals, and presidents. He wrote about ordinary people caught in extraordinary situations.
Ira Hayes, a full-blooded Pima Indian, was a gung-ho Marine at the outbreak of World War II. He played a small part in raising the flag on Mount Suribachi at Iwo Jima, and the government insisted he become a hero. A shy and private man, he was overwhelmed by the celebrity that was thrust upon him at one Bond rally after another. In The Hero of Iwo Jima, Huie writes about the anguish Hayes felt on his plush assignment while his buddies were dying on the beaches. The book sympathetically tells how the reluctant hero succumbed to alcoholism and died shortly after the war. Americans thought Ira Hayes was a hero. No one ever said that of Eddie Slovic, the only GI to be executed for desertion in World War II. But Huie had to find out why the Army needed to make an example of Slovic. Martin Sheen starred in the TV movie.
Come on!
We're gonna get killed, Jimmy!
Watch out!
Get down!
Take cover!
Let's get out of here!
Come on, let's get out of here!
Maybe he made up his mind that night, I don't know, but after that first time, I think he finally decided that what's under fire was enough.
You know, I remember the day Slovic came back after his court-martial. He wasn't so happy. He and those kids around figured he might be stuck in jail for 2 or 3 years. Of course, it never occurred to him, even after he got the sentence, that he'd actually be shot.
Darling, I'm in a little trouble. Please don't worry about me, because I'm all right.
And Bill maintained that this boy, and he was a boy, he was an immature, not very bright young man, who couldn't take the stress of war, who begged to be relieved, you see, was deliberately chosen for execution because he was a nobody who didn't come from a particularly strong ethnic group or constituency.
And this was the whole point of Bill's story about it and exposing this, was that he was unfairly and unjustly treated because he was poor, because he was uneducated, because he had no connections, because he was scared to death.
If able-bodied soldiers know they can avoid hazardous duty, how do you fight a war?
Well, come on, Frank. Able-bodied men have been avoiding hazardous duty for years. We haven't shot any of them.
Maybe it's time we started.
Well, I suppose it makes it easier the fact that he's a confirmed felon.
He isn't. He was a petty criminal, bad boy type. Lots of them make good soldiers.
Would you ask him to please shoot straight so I don't have to suffer? Father, I want you to tell the fellas in the regiment that Eddie Slovic wasn't a coward. At least not today.
What? Ready? Aim! Fire! Order! Arm!
I think execution of Private Slovic until maybe In Cold Blood was the best nonfiction book of reportage that we've ever had. And I think it's still in one of the top two or three. It shows a magnificent piece of work of detection.
There might have been 50 writers who could have seen that. Oh, a guy got executed. Yeah, so what? Bill saw it, and he wrote this note to himself that said, the only man in such a situation deserves to be known. I've got to dig him up.
He was the first investigative reporter, and that's what this shows. I mean, this guy went in and investigated it, found the truth, and then wrote one hell of a book about it.
The execution of Private Slovic was the most watched television movie ever when it aired in 1974. For another kind of writer, it might have served as a capstone to a career that had lasted six decades. Huie was determined to match its success, but there was little interest in his subjects. The civil rights movement was languishing. America was obsessed with Vietnam, not Huie's war. Once he had been close to the action in the South. Now, he was an isolated, small-town Southern writer.
He did a book about Forrestal, which should have been a stunning book. But he couldn't cope dealing with a New York publisher from Alabama.
In the hours of night, which Bill really invested a big part of his soul in writing, was not a successful book.
Huie's writing had made millions of dollars, but now most of it had been spent. And his wife, Ruth, his childhood sweetheart, was ill.
Before I came along, his wife, Ruth, had died of a 13-month battle with cancer. And Bill spent all kinds of money on that.
At an age when most people retire, Huie kept working. He felt he had no choice.
Bill had to earn a lot of money. He had a wife who was not well. And he built this beautiful home in Hartsell across the... First he built his mother's home, then he built his own home, and they were across the street from each other.
Bill has made... He made a lot of money in his time. He also spent a lot of money, and just about all of it went right back into writing.
He was at his desk in 1986 when he died at the age of 76. He was survived by his second wife. There were no children in either marriage. Sometimes in investigating his stories, William Bradford Huie paid for information. Many journalists resented that and still think it's unethical. He returned to the South just as one of the great stories in this century was unfolding there. But his move isolated him from the media capital of New York. His spirited independence enabled him to find stories where others never thought of looking. But that independence meant he was always a loner who struggled to keep his journalistic enterprise going. Even to this day, there's controversy about his checkbook journalism. And because he was a loner, there are no colleagues to champion his memory. Huie's books were out of print when he died.
How could a man do that much and be so little remembered for it?
What I feel about Bill was he was a genius, but his genius did not lay in his, or lie in his prose style. He was a genius, as I said earlier, about what to write, how to market it, all of that.
He was a conspicuous figure in the world of journalism in the early 50s, and at his best, a wonderful writer.
I think any serious historian of the American past, I think any conscientious scholar who wishes to look at the struggle for racial justice in the period of the 1950s and 1960s, must acknowledge Huie's role.
Here, through Huie's eyes, you get the workings of the human heart, and it's truly, truly a telling wonderful, emotional story. That's, I think, the mark, hallmark of William Bradford Huey's work.
In all of his writing, William Bradford Huey makes himself part of man's continuing struggle for freedom. He writes as a great reporter, but also as an impassioned man. He writes with clinical detail, but not with detachment. Those aren't my words. Martin Luther King Jr. said that about William Bradford Huey. Paying respect to William Bradford Huey, journalist, editor, officer, novelist, is not hard. Saying goodbye, dear Bill, is what's tough.
I'm not in the law enforcement business. I'm just in the business of establishing truth wherever possible. And I have to believe that the truth is good.